The hospitality of the proprietors of Mortefontaine was noble and honorable. They charmed their guests by a natural politeness and by their simple and affectionate manners. The vicinity of the estate of Plessis-Chaumont, which belonged to Lucien Bonaparte, rendered communications with Mortefontaine frequent and did much to enhance the charm of the two residences. There was nothing pompous about either place, but they were the rendezvous of men of varied merits. In this respect, Plessis was the rival of Mortefontaine. The presiding taste at Plessis was for the performances of tragedies. These performances were given under the direction of the actor Lafon. Lucien had lost his first wife, Christine Boyer, who had left him with two daughters. One of them has married the Roman Prince Gabrielli. The other, after the death of her first husband, married Lord Dudley Stuart. Madame Bacciocchi, who was tenderly attached to her brother, spent the summer at Plessis, warmly protecting the poet Fontaine. The Marquise de Santa Cruz, a Spanish lady whose acquaintance Lucien had made whilst ambassador to Madrid, helped Madame Bacciocchi to do the honors of the house and was supposed to have a very great influence over him. Joseph Bonaparte used to make frequent excursions from Mortefontaine to La Malmaison, in which I had the honor of accompanying him. We used to spend part of the day there, coming back to Mortefontaine after dinner. Dinner was served at La Malmaison, at one table only, where often a family reunion might be seen. The first consul sat on one side, having Madame Louis Bonaparte Hortense next to him, and Madame Bonaparte opposite. The aides-de-camp of the first consul were admitted to his table, and generally one of the consuls, a minister, and one or two ladies were amongst the guests. Strangers were rarely seen there. I will mention, in a summary manner, the events which took place in the interval which elapsed between the signing of the Treaty of Luneville and the conclusion of the Concordat. Events which were brought about by the accession to power of the mighty genius who already exercised such a great influence on the destinies of Europe. The abuse which England made of her maritime supremacy, the tyranny which she exercised over the shipping of other maritime powers, our victories, the treaties which had been their consequence, the wisdom and the skill of the government of the First Consul had produced a revolution in the minds of men throughout Europe. The influence which England had enjoyed was rapidly declining. Her despotism had revolted the powers of the North, who had united in a convention, the direct object of which was to enforce the respect of neutrals. The Emperor Paul I had put himself at the head of his league with his customary ardor. The general embargo under which England laid the ships of the countries which had signed this convention and her treacherous attack upon Copenhagen only tightened the bonds of the coalition against her. The First Consul had spared no effort to bring about an understanding with the Emperor Paul. There were 7,000 Russian prisoners in France, whom the First Consul fitted out with clothes and sent back home ransom free. This action finally won the heart of Paul I. He had contracted a close alliance with France and was vigorously pursuing the execution of the plans agreed upon in concert with her when he was ruthlessly assassinated. The particulars of the murder of this prince are well known today, and there is no necessity for me to repeat them. The Moniteur announced this evening in the following terms. Paul I died in the night of the 24th to the 25th of March. The English fleet passed the Sound on the 31st. History will teach us what connection may exist between these two occurrences. The effect of this catastrophe was a dissolution of the league of which Paul I had been the most ardent promoter. Before long, a total change in the policy of Russia took place. General Duroc had been sent to St. Petersburg to compliment the new emperor on his accession and to endeavor to continue the relations which had existed between his father and the First Consul. Duroc had been received with kindness and with protestations of a desire to continue on friendly terms with France. But about 6 weeks later, the Emperor Alexander signed a treaty with England by which he abandoned all his father's projects and submitted to the exactions of that power. The death of General Kleber had let the command of the French army fall into the hands of General Menou, who was invested therewith by right of seniority. He was a brave officer and a good administrator, but lacked in military qualities. He was devoted to French political interests in Egypt. In this interest, he had become a Muslim and had married a Turkish girl. The general of the Army of the East, either from a want of confidence in their commander-in-chief, or from a spirit of rivalry with him, only yielded him a constrained obedience. And the divisions which ensued therefrom contributed to the ruin of the expedition. The English profited by this to send a picked army to Egypt, which combined its operations with an Ottoman army. The First Consul had made useless efforts to send reinforcements of troops and provisions to Egypt. Menou committed the error of not marching with his troops to oppose the debarkation of the English troops and to drive them back into the sea. He divided his troops and was everywhere outnumbered. It was thus that he lost the most important battle of Nicopolis, where he succumbed to greatly superior numbers. General Abercrombie lost his life there. General Billiard in Cairo and General Menou in Alexandria were forced to capitulate and to accept the conditions of the enemy, who accorded the transport of the French army with arms and baggage back to France. It was about this time that the Infanta of Parma, in whose favor the Treaty of Luneville had created the Kingdom of Etruria, came to Paris with the Queen under the names of Count and Countess Leghorn. They spent a month there in a series of fêtes. It had seemed to the First Consul that it would be a good stroke of policy to exhibit a Bourbon in Paris, a Bourbon created king by his omnipotence. By the omnipotence of him who made men kings without wishing to be a king himself, and to admit to the Tuileries a prince who sprang from the blood which had reigned over France, at a time when his presence did not create the least sensation in Paris, but when, on the contrary, his entire worthlessness was patent to all who saw him. The conferences about to concord it followed on the negotiations for the Treaty of Luneville. It was a fixed idea in the mind of the First Consul that religion should be reestablished in France. He was firmly convinced of the importance of a religion to a nation. Catholicism seemed at its last gasp. Most of the men who had any influence in public affairs seemed disposed to embrace the Protestant religion. But on the other hand, the large majority of Frenchmen were disposed to the Roman Catholic faith. This attachment is indestructible in the larger number of departments. In spite of the immense confidence which the First Consul inspired, his influence did not extend to the point of being able to make a selection between the two forms of religion. From an adoption of Protestantism, dissensions were to be expected, all the more violent because the remembrance of the religious wars had not yet been effaced. Could a schism then be created at a time when the progress of civilization and the personal inclinations of the head of the state prescribed the union and conciliation of all parties? But apart from the motive that, born a Roman Catholic, it was distasteful to him to abandon this religion for any other, other motives also impelled him to give his preference to Roman Catholicism. France, being surrounded by Roman Catholic states, needed all her advantages. A repudiation of her ancient faith would have weakened her prestige, and at the same time would have aroused in Europe the anxieties which the errors of the Revolution had justified. In maintaining the Roman Catholic religion, the First Consul secured the Pope to his interests and profited by an influence which, at that time, could not fail to be of service to his government. Italy remained attached to France. Napoleon's mental reservation was to bring the Catholic faith back to evangelical purity and to effect the separation of the spiritual and temporal power, a separation which in his eyes seemed destined to assure religious peace. This immense result, which later on was very nearly secured, would perhaps have exercised a great influence on the tranquility of Europe and have set at rest much religious discord without fear of any return. In this, as in many other things, the first consul was before his time. Someday, no doubt, the future will realize his plans. In matters of religion, however, progress must be slow and gradual. Reforms of this nature cannot be combined in ministries. They are the work of circumstances and of time. They must come at the right moment, nor does it appertain to any human power to hurry on their accomplishment. It was a matter of primary importance to reunite people divided by religious discords, and in so doing to satisfy the almost general wish of the French people. Some of these considerations were developed by the councilors of state, who exposed the motives of the concordat negotiations to the tribunate and the legislative body. Full of these lofty plans, the first consul resolved to attempt a reconciliation with the Holy See. He had much resistance to overcome on the part of his ministers. Monseigneur Spina, Archbishop of Corinth, was sent to Paris to open negotiations, the preliminary articles proposed by the French government having been agreed to, with some modifications, by the Council of Cardinals, the Holy Father, to invest this act with more solemnity and to assure its prompt accomplishment, sent his Secretary of State, Cardinal Consalvi, who arrived in Paris at the beginning of June. He had several conferences with the first consul, and the consequence was that negotiations were opened between the papal envoys, Cardinal Consalvi, the Archbishop of Corinth, and Father Caselli, His Holiness's consulting theologian, the French plenipotentiary, Joseph Bonaparte, to whom the first consul adjoined the councilor of state, Crete, and Abbe Bernier, formed curé at Saint-Laud-d'Angay. This priest, after having been the soul of the insurrectional government in La Vendée, had seconded General Edouville's work of conciliation in that district to the entire satisfaction of the first consul. A national council was convened 8 days after Cardinal Consalvi's arrival in Paris. 45 archbishops and bishops and 80 ecclesiastical deputies of the Second Order met together at Notre Dame. In a new declaration, the principles of the Gallican Church. This assembly declared that the Church of France recognizes the Pope as its head, but denied him any right in the temporal affairs of the state. This declaration seemed destined to lay the basis of the projected convention and to support the impending negotiations. These were long drawn out, and it was only the fear lest the first consul might yield to the persuasions of the councilors of state, the majority of whom were in favor of Protestantism, and the threatened establishment of the Gallican Church that decided Cardinal Consalvi to conclude. The preliminary articles, which had been agreed upon with Monseigneur Spina, Archbishop of Corinth, were converted to the definitive treaty, which was signed on the 15th of July and was ratified by a papal bull dated 15th August following. Abbe Bernier was rewarded for his participation in these negotiations with the See of Orléans. When the concordat agreement was made public, the Republican Party and the ideologists, as Napoleon used to call him, severely blamed this arrangement with the court of Rome, asserting that it was a return to Gothic ideas, to introduce a foreign power into the state and to accord a privilege to the Roman Catholic clergy in a country where the equality of all religious creeds had been proclaimed. Others, less passionate, whilst admitting that this arrangement had some advantages, expressed the wish that the marriage of priests should have been permitted by the new law. But the most regrettable omission was that of a clause fixing the time in which the Pope should canonically institute the bishops. This matter had been discussed in the conferences at the time of the concordat negotiations. It was thought, however, that sufficiently large concessions had already been obtained from the Pope, and that it was not just to insist on that one. This omission had become a terrible weapon in the hands of the head of the church. Those who blamed the French government for not having secured liberty for priests to marry and having omitted to establish a gallery Vatican Church forgot that such reforms cannot be improvised, that for the time being, considerable advantages had been obtained, and that ameliorations, which time alone can bring to maturity, must be hoped for from the march of events. However this may be, the Concordat was productive of great good. It was a pledge of reconciliation to the large majority of Frenchmen, whilst abolishing the distinctions which existed between unsworn and sworn priests. It, at the same time, dissipated the scruples which were felt by those who had acquired national property. Morality found once more the powerful sanction of religion, for it is the respect for religious opinions which assures the empire of law. On the other hand, the Concordat was a step in the direction of the reforms rendered necessary by the progress of human enlightenment, which Napoleon had in preparation. The clergy ceased to be a body in the state. It was salaried and subjected to discipline, a discipline to which for many years it submitted in conformity with the law, restricting itself to the limits of its attributions. Restrained by the strong hand of the chief of the state, it would never have attempted to emancipate itself had not the difficulties which were later on thrown in the path of the government encouraged its pretensions and given rise to cavils, which grew as the times became worse. It cannot be denied that the encroachments of the court of Rome sorely tested the emperor's patience and often rendered vain the precautions which, at the dictates of his foresight, he had taken to protect the rights of the state against the enterprise of the priests. The troubles caused by the influential party of the clergy, encouraged in their hostilities by the reverses which our armies have suffered, have gained the cause of the traducers of the Concordat and justified, in appearance at least, the censures passed upon this great act. The French government, without doubt, has reaped a bitter harvest from a treaty which was inspired by the desire to bring back peace to the church and was accorded to the desires of the representative of a God of peace and charity on earth. But Napoleon would have triumphed over all embarrassments which it caused him if the pacification of Europe had allowed him to do so. A pastoral letter which was issued from Rome simultaneously with the ratification of the Concordat exhorted the French bishops to resign their sees, a delay of 3 months being granted them in which to pronounce themselves. Almost all old incumbents had made haste to accede to the wishes of the Pope and sent in their patents. A very small number of former prelates who had retired to England showed themselves recalcitrant and formed a center of opposition which received the name of Little Church. Their resistance passed unnoticed. The bull which suppressed the archbishoprics and bishoprics which had existed at the time of the revolution was nonetheless put into execution in the place of the 23 archbishoprics and the 134 bishoprics which were abolished. Only 10 archbishoprics and 50 bishoprics were created. The articles of the Concordat were not published. No communications of this act was made to the tribunate, nor to the legislative body after its conclusion. The apparent reason of this delay was the necessity of awaiting the resignation of the incumbents of the ancient sees, among whom were a certain number of emigres who might be expected to refuse to resign. But the principal reason was the fear of brusquely making matters which concern the peace of men's consciences the subject of the discussions of the umbrageous and speculative minds who dominated in the National Tribune. The publication of the Concordat was postponed to the opening of the second session of the legislative body. This interval was made use of in preparing in the Council of State various regulations which were necessary for the coordination of the religious system of the state with the needs of the nation and the progress of enlightenment. I must speak in connection with the Concordat of a measure which, to a great extent, decided the early communication of this convention to the legislature and the tribunate. The sessions of these two assemblies, and notably that of the Tribunate, had been marked by violent opposition. The majority of the laws presented to them had been unfavorably received. Two even had been rejected. Hostile words had been pronounced in the Tribune. These convinced the first consul that he could not count in this direction on any sincere cooperation, and that the presence of these orators, whom he considered evilly disposed or led astray by an ill-timed zeal for public liberty, would be fatal to the introduction of the ameliorations which he had conceived. The renewal of the fifths, both of the Tribunate and of the legislative body, which by the terms of the Constitution had to be effected annually, seemed to him a favorable opportunity for ridding himself of the members who had the most opposed the laws proposed by the government. The method of the renewal of these fifths of the members, both of the Tribunate and of the legislative body, never having been defined by a constitutional act, the Senate was free to effect it either by election or by drawing lots. The first method was adopted. At the re-election of four-fifths of the two bodies, the 20 most recalcitrant tribunes were eliminated. The influence of the government was seen in this act of the Senate, in which it had to be recognized. The law had not been materially violated. This purification, for so it must be called, provoked and still provokes the reprobation of honorable and independent men, familiar rather with theory than enlightened by practice, and who for the most part profess the motto, "Let the state perish rather than principles." This measure was, however, one of urgent necessity. The firm desire to obtain good laws had either to be persisted in or to be abandoned under pressure of men who, for the most part, thought the young government weak and who wanted to render themselves indispensable by means of systematic opposition. There could be no doubt which of these two alternatives the first consul would choose. The Concordat was the first law presented at the extraordinary session convened on the 5th of April. It was adopted by a very large majority. On the 18th of April, Easter Sunday, a Te Deum was sung in the Church of Notre Dame to celebrate the reestablishment of religious worship and the peace of Amiens. The first consul assumed on this occasion a green court dress with gold embroideries. He wore the regent, a diamond of great beauty, in the guard of his sword. This diamond was called the regent after the Duke d'Orléans, who had bought it during the minority of Louis XV to adorn the royal crown. Stolen from the Garde Meuble during the revolution and afterwards discovered, this diamond had been pledged by the government. It was for sale at much less than its value when the first consul bought it in. Mass was said by Cardinal Caprara in the presence of the diplomatic body. The bishops who had been nominated took the oath. In the evening, the city was illuminated throughout. The opposition of the free-thinking party manifested itself on the part of some of the generals in quibbles which only provoked smiles of contempt. Their first impressions had suggested the very worst designs against the person of the first consul, who was by no means in ignorance of the fact, but reflection brought wiser counsels. Many leading generals met together to discuss the matter. Some wildly excited men carried their madness to the point of suggesting that the first consul should share in the fate of Romulus. Bernadotte was among their number. Napoleon, who was always indifferent to his personal safety, refused to act on the reports which he received concerning this matter. His stoicism remained unshaken. He contented himself with roughly scolding the principal leaders. Some he sent away. Bernadotte was sent off to the army in the West, which he had left to come to Paris. His attitude towards the head of state became from that time so equivocal and strange that his chief staff officer, the general of brigade, Simon, was removed from the army. I have seen Napoleon at the time that I am speaking of so incensed against Bernadotte that he spoke of having him tried by court-martial. It was only thanks to the intervention of Joseph Bonaparte, Bernadotte's brother-in-law, that the general escaped this jurisdiction.